Really good to see you all. Even if some of you are just from here up, I get to see you. It's great to see you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for taking the necessary precautions to make this possible. As you know, this is our first Sunday back into this space, and we're doing the best we can. So thank you for all of that. It's just good to see everybody. Well, not everybody, but at least those of you who've shown up. We are also sending this out on live stream for those who, if you know friends or family or neighbors who would prefer this worship service, but they just aren't comfortable getting here yet, let them know that this is available on live stream. We'd like to say thank you to everyone who helped with our revival on Friday night. We had about 100 people show up, but we also had 275 people tune in on the live stream of it, which was really great. So, or at least 275 connections. By the time I do the preacher map for that, I hear that it's like 12,000 people that we reached. But again, it's just so good to have you here today. And again, thank you. It is a blessing to be here. And as we prepare our hearts for worship, I want to invite our handoff folks to come ahead and get into place. And they're going to play for us this morning prior to our reading.
So as we go through this service this morning, it will look different as we do things a little differently. We will not be standing for the hymns. You're welcome to sing right where you are. The goal is just not to stand up and project stuff. I hate to be as crude as that, but that's the reality. And you're welcome to sing along. Those will be led. All the words for all that we do will be up on the screen. And we're going to figure this out as we go, and I appreciate your patience. And also know that if you're sitting anywhere and you need more space, we've got more space. So that's great. You can move. You're not going to bother me at all. So just do whatever you need to do to get where you feel you are most comfortable. I would like to direct you to our greeting, which will be on the screen here. And together, we're going to go into the greeting. and if you will, respond with what is in bold. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is none other. The hour is coming, and now is, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for such the Father seeks to worship Him. The psalm also says that it is good to be in the house of the Lord, and that is certainly true this day. And Leanne's going to lead us in our first song. At least she has the hymn book open. I'm hoping it's Leanne. So here is our opening hymn, and again, the words will be up on the screen for you. So please sing along if you feel comfortable. Thank you. I think we got the third verse up there. Do y'all want to do the third verse? You good? Okay. As I said, we're getting used to this, and thank you for your patience as we work to our first service back in here. It's hard to believe since the middle of March. I never would have dreamed we'd been absent from this space for that long, but it's great to be back. One of the things I'd like to lift up to you is some of the things that this church is doing. And you know many of these things, but there's a truck that's heading to Louisiana this week that is loaded down with stuff to help those folks who've had such a horrific time with the hurricane and the hurricane season. And as you know, those hurricanes seem to be just piling up. They come one after another, after another, after another. But thank you for helping fill up that trailer with all kinds of things to help those folks out. And that's just part of what this church does. Another wonderful ministry this church does is called Furnish a Future. Furnish a Future gives people the opportunity to donate furniture And then that furniture is then turned around and given to folks who are moving from a transitional situation. Most of these folks, most of them are women with children who are moving from shelters where they've escaped abuse. And as you know, they've left everything behind. And when they're starting over and continuing that journey, to make that transition into a home that is furnished is a big deal. One of the pushes behind this new mission center is to give furnished a future the space they need to be able to collect this furniture so that we can bless folks who are in that situation. And so just remember that ministry in your prayers. We have some guys who have become excellent movers over the years. Some of them get impressed into that. That's a good military term, which means you're kind of forced into it. But they do a great job moving all that furniture and getting all those apartments and homes set up. So thank you for that. And at this time, as we go into our time of prayer, I want to invite Mr. David Washko to come forward. If you haven't met David yet, David is our Director of Discipleship Ministries here. And I'm thrilled to have David on the team and have him part of our church staff and leading these ministries. So if you've got any questions, first, if you've got any praises about how good things are going around here, talk to me. If you've got any complaints, talk to David. But David, if you have any questions about small groups, small group ministries, if you have an idea for a new ministry, or you need any assistance with your class or your Sunday school class, David's the guy who will be the one helping you out with that. So thank you, David. And David's going to be leading us in our time of prayer this morning. And together we will conclude our time of prayer by praying the Lord's Prayer together.
Good morning. It's a great morning for us to join in prayer together. Please join me. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this day that is before us. The brisk air is so refreshing, Father. And Lord, that's what you call upon us as Christians to be, a fresh aroma for all those who run into you, those who interact with and fellowship with us. And so, Father, we just thank you for your mightiness, your abundant grace and mercy. And Father, we just ask for your forgiveness when it comes to the times that we allow to be distracted. Distracted from you is a checklist, distracted with you. And the runnings around that we have to do and we choose to do. And so, Lord, I just ask that we agree together, Father, that we will just be more intentional with our time with you. Lord, we know you want to have that intimate time with us. And so, Lord, I ask that together as a congregation, that we make that commitment to just have that quiet time. Father, may we also be grateful for being back in this building. Not that the building itself is important, Father, but it's just a sense of comfort, a sense of normalcy. Father, we just thank you that we have this opportunity to blaze a new trail, to blaze a new time with you, Father, and remember what it's like to fellowship together as a church, as a body. Lord, now we come to you in the manner and the way that Christ has taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
irony of calling a capital campaign right now in March to think about that. It didn't happen right now. And it wasn't lost on me. But what we're doing is calling this even now. That we believe God has called us to build this mission center primarily even now. God's calling us to get rid of that debt that this church has carried since about the year 2000. Like 20 years, two decades of paying debt payments, but even now is the time to go ahead and get rid of that. And if there's any additional funds, we'll be set aside for interior renovations in accordance with the new plan. So that's the scope of the plan. But the most important piece of this is this mission center. It's this ability to increase our missional footprint, to be able to do even more for this community, to take ministries that are in storage spaces and garages and rental units and be able to put them in one place to be more effective and more efficient. God calls us to this. We know that. It's clear in Scripture, which is our Scripture for today. It comes to us from James. And if you're familiar with the book of James, you know, James doesn't beat around the bush. James just gets right to the point and says, this is what you need to be doing. James was known in church tradition as Old Camel Knees. How would you like to have that for a nickname? Old Camel Knees. Because it was, the tradition was that he spent so much time in prayer that he had calluses on his knees. And his connection to the Spirit of Christ, and church tradition also holds that James was the brother of Christ. His connection to Jesus is seen in this. And it's also that kind of just saying, this is what you need to do. If you ever wonder, anybody ever wonder, what's God's will for my life? Well, about 95% of that's in James. He just tells us what to do. And here's one of those times where James just tells us what to do. James chapter 2, and I'm going to read verses 14 through 17. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessings. And we thank you for how good you are to us. We ask that as we take some time to look at your scripture, that we hear from you and what you would have to say to us this day. In the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. I want to tell you a story about a guy named Joe. Because, well, that's his real name. And he lived not far from where I grew up, in that little mountain community down this little curvy road where not many people lived. And my brothers and I were terrified of Joe. Well, he scared us to death. Why? Because Joe lived in what looked pretty much like a shack. It had been a nice little house once upon a time, but those years had come and gone, and it was grown up in weeds and car parts. And if you were to draw a caricature of what a southern Appalachian house looked like, well, that would have been Joe's house. I mean, complete with the old recliner on the front porch with holes in the porch and all that good stuff. He had three or four mangy old dogs that lived with him. And Joe didn't drive. He walked everywhere. And he only wore one outfit. And that was a blue one-piece work, I don't know, you call them a jumper. I don't know what you call it, but it was just, oh, he had the coveralls. There you go. That's all he, and he had this huge, long, white beard, long, white hair, and he scared us absolutely to death because he seemed like he was kind of a wild man. And we would wave at Joe, you know, when you're driving by in the car, you can throw up a hand, but we avoided having any contact with Joe. Well, that's just because we were kids and terrified. So it sticks in my memory very clearly Leading up to Christmas one year, I was, I guess, about 10, which meant my brother Jeff would have been 11. And Mom was making fudge. And she made fudge, homemade fudge, every Christmas, which was something we certainly looked forward to, right? And got in fights about who got to lick the spoon, who got to lick the pot, and all that kind of stuff. And so she has this amazing batch of fudge made, and we're just waiting to tear into it. And she puts it in a tin, a little round tin, with a, and she hands it to us, and she goes, "You boys aren't getting any fudge until you take this over to Joe." She knew how to get things done, right? If you can't beat your kids into submission, then bribe them. And believe me, she tried the former. We didn't want to go. I mean, here, 10, 11 years old, to walk across the south field there over to Joe's old ratty house and knock on the door and risk that he may be home. The whole way over there, we're just hoping, I hope Joe's out somewhere so we can just leave this on the front porch and run away. But wouldn't you know it, we come up to the front door and we do one of these. Right? And guess who opened the door? There's Joe with these, and he had these piercing blue eyes. And Jeff and I are standing there, two terrified little boys, and we're just holding a tin of fudge, and we go. And I think we managed to mumble, "Mom said to bring this to you." And of course, it's a small community, and he knows who we are. And my mom could even go through the lineage to explain how we were related to him, because we were related to everybody around there. And he took that tin of fudge and he held it very gingerly, and he looked at it and said, "This is so nice. Thank you." We didn't even know the man could talk. And he's holding it and he goes, this is so great, because I really like this tin. Because now it's hard to keep the rats out of my stuff. I mean, really, he had a hard time keeping the mice out of whatever he had in his house. But I took whatever I want to in here, and the rats can't get to it. You know, when Jeff and I returned to our own home, we didn't complain about sharing a room anymore. We didn't complain, at least for a week, about Mom feeding us sauerkraut all the time. I don't know how much we changed Joe that day by showing him a little compassion, but by sharing some compassion with Joe, it certainly changed both of us. And I wonder, you know, both of us are pastors now. I don't know what that interaction with Joe meant for either of our journey completely, but I know that it gave us a sense of empathy for other people, a sense that everyone's God's creation and that we're called to care for everyone, even if they do scare you to death as a 10-year-old kid. It's also one of those things that Jesus is very clear about. There should be no ambiguity about taking care of those who are less fortunate. Although sometimes we misconstrue some of Jesus' words and we use it as an excuse. Are you familiar with the verse I'm talking about? And do you remember Matthew chapter 26, verse 11? When Jesus is heading to the cross and his feet are anointed and all this perfume is used, and someone goes, "Well, why should all that been used and wasted on Jesus when the money could have been given to the poor?" And Jesus says this verse, it's this curious statement. He says, "For the poor you will always have with you." You ever heard that? "For the poor you will always have with you, but you will not always have me with you." You ever heard anyone use that as a reason not to take care of the poor? Well, even Jesus said, "For the poor you will always have with you." So, they're always going to be with us. Why should we worry about them? We can't do anything about it. The poor, oh, they're always with us. So, we can go on with our lives and know that no matter what we do, we'll never fix that problem. That's not what Jesus was saying. This is one of those things, times when the context really matters. It almost always matters in Scripture, by the way, that in this particular place, the context really matters. Sometimes we forget context. We forget what it's used in. For instance, have you ever heard phrase in Shakespeare. It's sweet for the sweet. Anybody ever heard that phrase? Sweet for the sweet. And there's been many of a young man who thought he was being super romantic and given his sweetheart or his wife or whomever some chocolate and said, sweet for the sweet. And it's like, here, I'm giving you chocolate and I'm quoting Shakespeare. I'm awesome. But if you go and read where that comes from in Hamlet, it's when Hamlet's mother is throwing flowers on Ophelia's grave. It's a act of mourning. It's an act of death. Sweet for the sweet is an act of complete destruction. So if you're going to ever quote Shakespeare in a romantic relationship, please don't say sweet for the sweet. Or what you're really saying is, please take this and die. So context matters, and context really matters with what Jesus says in Matthew, because we have to remember that audience, the first audience that heard Jesus say those words, they knew their scripture so well. Jesus knew his scripture so well. And in Deuteronomy, it says this, and I'm going to read this to you because it's just so vitally important. The people could finish scripture when it started. You could just say a few words and they would know what came next. It's kind of what we do with idioms. What must go up must come down, right? You know that. You just know it intuitively. Well, that's how well they knew scripture. And here's the scripture that Jesus was referring to in Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 15, chapter verses 7 through 9 reads, If there is among you anyone in need, a member of your community, in any of your towns, within the land that the Lord your God has given you, do not be hard-hearted or tight-fisted toward your needy neighbor. You should rather open your hand willingly, lending enough to meet the need, whatever it may be. Be careful that you do not entertain a mean thought. I think we should just stop there. It would be great if everybody could be careful not to entertain a mean thought. Because every seventh year, they forgave all the debt, right? And basically it's saying, don't entertain a mean thought thinking, oh, they won't have time to pay me back. Basically, Deuteronomy, the law of Moses, the very law of God, is saying, take care of those in need. And then it goes on to say this in verse 10. Give liberally and be ungrudging when you do so. For on this account, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in all that you undertake, since there will never cease to be poor among you on the earth. I therefore command you, open your hand to the poor, needy neighbor in your land. That's what Jesus was talking about. He's talking about the law of Moses in Deuteronomy. He's saying the poor you always have with you. And he didn't even have to finish the sentence because they knew how to finish the sentence for him. Because they already knew when he said, the poor you will always have with you, they knew what they were supposed to do for those people. This isn't a license in Matthew. Jesus isn't giving us a license to ignore the poor. As a matter of fact, he goes out of his way to talk how vitally important it is. He says towards the end of Matthew, Matthew chapter 25, the way you treat them is the way you have treated me. There's no ambiguity about that whatsoever. But I'm not here to give anybody a guilt trip. Don't worry about that. Although if one's warranted, you should probably take it, just saying. What's fascinating to me is this imagery of not being tight-fisted. Right? You ever try to go through life that way? How many people are in that position right now? Just hanging on, gripping with all your heart and soul to the possessions that you have as if those would give you a future. You know anyone like that? You can almost see their knuckles are white because they're gripping their possessions so tightly. Don't be tight-fisted. Be open-handed. It's a completely different way of living, isn't it? Be open-handed. Be generous. And this is a hard thing to teach. It's a hard thing that sometimes I struggle to teach this to my kids. I have to say, the other day, my daughter Elizabeth, I brought her something home from Zaxby's. And if anybody's invested in Zaxby's stock and done well, you're welcome. My daughter has single-handedly upped their revenue greatly. And so I went by Zach's feet, I picked it up, I brought it home, and I sat it on the table, and she sat down to eat it, and I reached over to get a French fry. And what do you think she said? Those are mine. And I was like, I'm going to kill you. I paid for that. I drove over there and got that, and I put it on the table for you. And I can't have a fry back. Anyway, how often do we do that with God? Right? God has given us so much, and yet here we are hanging on, saying, mine, it's mine, it's mine. It's no way to live our lives. It may feel good in the short term, but in the bigger picture, that's not what God intends for our lives, to be open-fisted. And ultimately, don't we serve a Lord who's open-handed? And think about that. What did it take for Jesus to go to the very cross of the Romans and give his life for us? He's open-handed, even to the point of death for our sake. And he asked us, that's a model for us of how to live, so to put others in a place before us. It's not the lessons we get from our culture, certainly, is it? Right? Me. But the way of blessing is to live open-handedly. And it spells it out here in Deuteronomy. I love these words. 15, this is the NRSV. Give liberally and be ungrudging when you do so. For on this account, the Lord your God will bless you. There's blessing in living an open-handed life. And I think about this congregation and what this congregation has been about for so long. You all know that. You've been around here and seen this church go from being over in the chapel to now being back in this space and to worshiping in an arbor and reaching lots and lots of people. Is that this church has for a long time been an open-handed congregation who's given back to this community. And I certainly see God has blessed those efforts. If you really want to know what drives this church, hard as it is for me to admit it, it's not my preaching. And none of your shots. It's the generosity of heart in this place because it is aligned with the Spirit of God. It's that spirit of giving, it's that spirit of releasing God's blessing back out into the community and caring for people, heart, mind, soul, and body. Because what James says is, faith without works is dead. What he's saying is, your faith should impact how you live. If it's just a subscription to a line of belief, if it's just doctrine and dogma, and you go, oh, I'll agree to those, okay, I'm good. That's not faith. What faith is a transformational relationship with a holy God to the person of Jesus Christ, impacted and shaped by the work of the Holy Spirit that makes us into whole new people. Whole new people who are able to navigate any situation, any circumstance in life, even the craziness of our world right now. The way to navigate that is by being Christian. It's by ascribing to the values of God Almighty. And by being part of what God is doing. Because that doesn't go away. That doesn't fade. That doesn't get torn down by an election cycle or by disease or by economies. The Word of God, the presence of God in the Church of Jesus Christ, we are promised that not even the gates of hell will prevail against it. And that's where our hope is. Because God changes the world, even through the likes of us. And so we get a chance to show this world what we value. Have you noticed that cultures tend to build what they value? I heard this a long time ago that if you want to know what a culture values, just pay attention to what they build. And what do we build anymore? What do we build? I don't know if you got a chance to watch NFL football last week. It was fun to watch. It was nice to see sports on TV again. It was weird to see no people in the stands. I don't know about the pumped-in crowd noise. That was a little weird. It's like everybody became an alumni of the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. You don't remember that, do you? They actually fake pumped-in crowd noise at the ding-dong. So, you know. And for those of you who are Carolina fans, so what? The Rams Stadium, when they played the Cowboys, did you see that game? They built a brand new stadium. It is absolutely amazing. $2.6 billion of amazing. $2.6 billion. What does our culture value? What do we value? We had a chance to show our community what we value. That we value them. That we value them. That we value our neighbors. That we value those who are in need. That we value looking at someone and saying, we care for your soul and we care for your physical needs. And I'm just so grateful to be a part of a congregation that has those kind of values. And so as we go from here to place this day, may we all learn to move from here to here and live our lives with that kind of grace, hope, and love. In the name of Christ, amen. And speaking of all that good stuff, if you did bring an offering with you today, you notice we didn't pass the plate. There is a box on the way out that you can drop an offering in if you did bring one with you today. So thank you again for your generosity in supporting the ministries of this church. Ann is going to lead us in our closing hymn. Again, remain seated. Please sing where you are if you feel so led. And then as she ends, I'll come and give a benediction and then instructions for how we exit safely and efficiently. Thank you. Thank you, Leanne. And thank you all for being here this day. Receive this benediction. May the Lord of love, grace, hope, and service, the God who is open-handed towards us, inspire us to be open-handed to others and therefore be a part of what God is always blessed in. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And so here's how we're going to exit. We have ushers who are going to exit from the back to the front. So you can pretend like you're at a wedding, kind of. And so, Kay, if you'll go ahead and get us started. And we also ask that if you want to speak to anyone, catch up to anyone, please do so outside, and that way we avoid any bottlenecks in our traffic flow. And David, give us some traveling music.